allow in and what I don't allow in, because my safety is in what I can control.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But actually, your safety is in what you give over to Jesus. I began to adjust my life, not to what my timetable said, but more upon the energies that I had and what am I giving my energy to.
As it grows up, it's almost like there's no room for there's no room for the negative growth.
Yes.
It's almost like the healthy growth of God's word all of a sudden consumes the negative in our heart.
Right.
You know, and consumes how we think, and all of a sudden it's like how you used to think, you don't think anymore.
Yes.
Well, welcome to Winning Conversations, and this is First Fridays in the month of September. And what an amazing opportunity to be able to film this in South Africa with the one and only, the great, amazing leader.
Oh, not too much of that.
Pastor John Bendixen. So I want to thank you, Justin, for, you know, connecting today and and connecting on our podcast. You and Sharon and you by yourself have been on podcasts for us. And, you know, I just want you to know how much I appreciate your gift.
Thank you.
Appreciate your leadership and appreciate all that you're doing here in South Africa, also in the United States.
Yeah.
You know how God
is
just expanding your borders, and
Amen.
And I love that. And I'm just happy to be connected with you now. For man, I just remember first picking you up and
20 plus years. At
yeah,
least.
I think that was 2000.
Yeah.
I think April of 2000.
Yeah.
So man, going on 25 years.
It's amazing how time flies, eh?
I mean, and we don't
and
we don't look
any
older.
You're in South Africa, and we're doing Winning Conversations in South Africa. I like that.
Isn't it amazing? Isn't it amazing?
Wow.
But so we can go ahead and get into this, and you know, as you asked me, it's like what was in my heart, and just being here for the time I have, and even last night at your message moments, and encourage anyone to go on to message moments, go on to the Heritage of Faith South Africa. They have an H logo. It's just a little different than ours, but I want to encourage you to go on and listen to their messages, because there's a great revelation, great insight coming from this house, and I believe the best is yet to come.
Amen.
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 But what was in my heart, as we were listening last night, was Isaiah chapter 55.
Mm.
And so let's just go ahead and jump into this.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
All right. So we'll pick this up, and actually, I'm going to pick it up in verse 6. And it says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he's near." It says, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to God, for he will abundantly pardon him. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord." You know, reading that scripture, and we're going to read some more verses here in a minute, but the key that we want to know, because a lot of times people would pull this one verse out, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord," and we leave it there as all of a sudden we're always in this position that we can't know his ways and we can't know his thoughts.
Right.
But I mean, we have 66 books of his thoughts.
That's right.
And we have the Holy Spirit that reveals things to us.
Yeah.
But I believe the key, starting off as what we're dealing with, is understanding the key, I think, is found in chapter 7, where it says, "Let the wicked forsake his way."
Yes.
Meaning I need to seek a new way.
Right.
You know, it's like I need to, you know, if I've been going this direction for a period of time, I need to all of a sudden seek a different way, because if I keep going my old way, I'll never know his thoughts. I'll never know his plans.
Yes.
And then it says, "And let the unrighteous man forsake his thoughts."
Right.
So that means if I want God's thoughts, I first of all have to forsake my thoughts.
Right.
What do you think about that, Pastor John?
You know, Pastor Justin, this, a lot of what happens in the book of Isaiah, I mean, Jesus, a lot of Jesus' ministry, and of course the disciples after him, a lot of their ministry is revealed, and the way they live, it was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah.
Yeah.
And then they often teach and quote scriptures that refer back to various, to the psalmist, to Isaiah, to various different prophets.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, I mean, I'm not making a direct connection between Matthew chapter 6 and Isaiah directly, but Matthew chapter 6, 33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added unto you."
Yeah.
And so this particular scripture kind of is encompassed in that one verse, because seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways, and the unrighteous and the unrighteous man his thoughts. So if he returns to the ways of God, then you're opening up a world of the things, that good things that God has for you. And he's saying, seek first, then these things. You know, seek first, then these things. And basically, those two scriptures refer to Matthew chapter 6. Or you can see them linking together like that, you know.
I totally agree. I mean, you're so right with way in the New Testament how Jesus or different ones refer to that. It's, you know, like even like kind of the verses, it's like you have eyes, but you don't see. You have ears, but you don't hear. You know, and I know for me, it was like church was like this. It was almost like it was a separate compartment in my day-to-day life. It wasn't like, wait a minute, no, this needs to be my life. And so therefore, we have a hard time putting God in this box of my every other part of my life, and we have this church part, and it's like I had a fear of trying to integrate the two. You know, because it was like, I want to do my own life, but then I'm hearing this. And it's like, okay, I don't want to change. You know what I mean? So it's like, and it's like, but wait a minute, I want what he has for me. I want to go where he wants me to go. I want to reach who he wants me to reach. And so that was a totally shift in my thinking that, wait a minute, Justin, you don't know the right way. You know, and so.
You know, it's such an interesting way that you've just put it, Pastor Justin. I'd say it like this, you know, all of us have accumulated negative energies, you know, from parents that didn't have a full understanding of the way God's ways were, from being at school, being in business, whatever the circumstances of life, we've accumulated negative energies. And part of what happens to us is that in putting God into everyday life, you know, you're actually wanting to and make this conscious decision where you're saying, I want to be in control of my energy. I want to be in control of what I allow in and what I don't allow in, because my safety is in what I can control. You know? But actually, your safety is in what you give over to Jesus. And so it's amazing. People want to control what happens in the world because they don't want negative energies. But by trying to control their world, they're creating negative energies because they don't let God in. And so there's that why it is in verse 6, seek the Lord while he might be found. Call upon him. Because that's an open heart. That's saying, Lord, can I have your ways? Can I have your light? Can I have your thoughts? Can I have? And so that's as we read on in this chapter, you know, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your. That's a good thing. Because as we get to know them, then we say, my seeking has brought me to know him. And so now I can walk away from my unrighteous ways. Otherwise, there's no way we can do it.
We can't.
I mean, even that scripture says, let the wicked forsake his ways and the unrighteous man his thoughts and let him return to the Lord. That's, first of all, a hard choice. But the power to do that is in the seeking.
It's in that pursuit. And, you know, as you were talking about the negative energies and, you know, whether we open ourselves up to our maybe wrong choices or things other people, like, you know, being raised in a certain way and experiencing things that ultimately you shouldn't have had to go through. And there was things I opened myself up to, and you know, we can be good at protecting ourselves because we don't want to be hurt. And so with me experiencing negative experiences in relationships, it was like I wouldn't extend myself into other relationships because I would be like, well, I like me, and I know me isn't going to hurt me. So therefore, I'm guarded. But then if I'm guarded, then I don't really let people into my life that can really truly influence me. And as pastors, you know, we had conversations about people leaving the church and that. So I've had to, and the Lord's done an amazing work in me because I don't hold on to people as mine. And when people leave, there's just, I'm like, Lord, I can't, because if you let you let those things you go through, being hurt by parents or being hurt by things, and what happened, it guards you and makes you hard to where for you to have that tender heart to be able to open up really to the one that wants to change you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so, you know, getting back to the thing where you know you're not going to hurt you, or so you think.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, at least you're in control of your own emotions, your own responses, your own everything. So you want to control that. And sometimes there's a measure of fear, there's a measure of guilt, there's a measure of shame, there's a measure of I've got to confront my conscience on many different levels. And so that kind of, because you want to stay in control, you think that's the way I can live my life most successfully. Mm-hmm. But the reality is that God is the one who can fix all that with his life, with his thoughts, with his ways.
Right.
And if we let God in, then yes, you are not as in control as you used to be. And I think that's a good thing.
It is.
Even though most people would say, I'm not sure if I can let go. I'm not sure if I can let go. Please let go.
Oh, I was so worried about letting go because that I'd miss out on something.
Exactly.
I mean, you know, telling the stories at church yesterday, it's like there was something in me that wanted to pursue God, but there was me wanting to guard myself because it was like I'll never have any fun. I'll never do that. Yeah. And maybe people won't like me. When people see the real me, they won't like it.
Right.
And so therefore you keep putting on these masks and these disguises and all these things instead of saying, God, I want to look like the way you see me. I want to be the way you see me. And that cannot be apart from his word. But it all starts with that seeking him and forsaking my way.
Right.
Because when I do that, then I open myself up to change.
Yes, yes. And that requires a measure of vulnerability, you know, Pastor Justin.
I don't like that word. I don't like
exactly.
I don't like accountability. I don't like vulnerability.
Right,
I don't
losing
like transformation.
Control.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
But actually, you know, those are the things that open ourselves up to God being able to work on us. And so again, if you look at God through the eyes of an unhealthy fear and an unhealthy, if I let him in, I don't know if I can deal with the confrontation because he might ask me to give up things I'm not ready to give up. Mm-hmm. Well, sitting in this side of your emotion, I can see why one would think that way. And we have all thought that way. I mean, I'm even reminded of Brother Hagin, you know, where he had been in the ministry, I don't know, perhaps 60 years by that time, and he had a really amazing ministry to the whole body of Christ worldwide.
Yeah, for sure.
And the Lord told him to do Holy Spirit meetings, you know. Yeah. And he just didn't do it for 3 years. He didn't do it. And he ended up getting really sick physically and on the point of death. And the Lord said to him, if you repent of this and you obey me, I will heal you. Mm-hmm. But your lack of obedience has caused the enemy to be able to come in and make you sick. Mm-hmm. Of course, he was lying in his bed and he immediately repented and almost immediately he was healed.
Yeah.
But the reason he didn't want to do that is because his reputation, and he confessed to this later publicly.
Yeah.
You know, he said the reason he was resisting it is because he didn't want to be labeled with all of the flaky guys that were doing the flaky stuff in the flow of the Spirit.
Yeah.
So in the end, it was a lack of, it was a fear, it was his reputation, it was many things that, thank God, he actually confessed to and acknowledged it publicly for our sake.
Yeah.
That, you know, you can say, he has a man who's been walking with God for 60 years, and in his natural man, he still has to deal with that. He still has to become vulnerable to God.
Yeah.
He still has. So it's not a thing that if you do it once, you're always delivered of it.
Yeah.
You know, there's always new things that are coming into your life, and you've always got to be saying, I'm going to trust you, Lord. I'm going to seek after you. I'm going to call upon you while you're near to me. I'm going to exchange your thoughts for my thoughts. It's not that, as you said, it's not a thought. It's not a thing of my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, so you can never know them. Actually, through Jesus, he wants us to know his thoughts.
No doubt.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So good, Pastor John. Let's see. We'll go down to, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And it says, verse 10, For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Man, just because his thoughts are his you words are containers of thoughts.
Right.
Right. You know, so it's like with thoughts, it's like you to communicate the thoughts, you can only communicate them by words.
Yes.
I can't sit here silently and do a podcast.
And have everybody
and everyone just watch us. Just watch us because we have we have thoughts. No, the way I communicate the thought is through words. So his ways, his thoughts that are higher, he wants to communicate those through words. And I want to hear your understanding of this scripture.
Right.
And because I want to receive greater revelation. And this is one of the keys that I would go to teaching about the word.
Yes.
And I want to hear maybe a perspective that the Lord's shown you in this section of verses.
Yeah. Pastor Justin, you know, some years ago, being in the corporate world, you know, everything is really driven by a calendar and by tasks and by how efficient you are. Mm-hmm. And of course, the world has kind of drifted through the knowledge base of efficiency is one thing, but effectiveness is another thing. But mm-hmm. everything is driven by a calendar and how much time, what's the value of your time, how much do you want to earn based on how much time you give,
right.
You know. And of course, I went before the Lord about that, and he started giving me bits of revelation all the way back then. And I began to adjust my life, not to what my timetable said, but more upon the energies that I had and how much energy have I got in a day and what am I giving my energy to? Mm. Because I realized that God is actually not, he's not captured by time. Mm. We live in a three-dimensional world, so time is our measurement system.
Right.
But God doesn't need to have a measurement system that is a man's measurement system.
Right.
He's outside of that measurement system. So if I'm going to seek his ways and his thoughts and the abundance of God, I've got to think outside of the way that humans think.
Yeah.
And so from back then, I began to explore the idea of if I just look at my energy as a way of measuring what I do rather than time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I always gain to live by time because we had to set a time to come and sit here.
Yeah.
So it's the way we order our energy.
Yeah.
But actually, if you just take what we're doing here, we've both come and brought our energies. But this time of our energy is both made up of a revelation that you received, mm-hmm. lots of it, revelations that I've received, and it's taken energy to bring you to this point.
Yes.
So now we're both expending energy to bring about this conversation.
Right.
And so I began to make declarations that my energy is being useful to God and being directed by God as he would direct my energy more than my time.
Yeah.
So then I can live in a dimension of energy productivity rather than time productivity. Mm-hmm. And when I look at these scriptures and I say, okay, Lord, if I'm in your thoughts and I'm in your ways more than in my thoughts, now I'm accessing an energy that's out of the three dimension. I'm accessing a fourth dimensional lifestyle that my energy can be measured on the realm of God's energy, not my own.
Yeah.
My energy, our energy is limited.
Yeah.
You know, in about 12 hours, we're going to need to sleep again.
Right.
You know, to replenish our energy.
Right.
But God's energy is timeless, limitless.
Yeah.
It's got no measurement to it. So if he says, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are his ways than our ways and his thoughts than our ways. I mean, this is an amazing thing that we can actually access that.
Yeah.
And so the way to do it is to do what he says in the rest of that scripture. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth and not return to me void. Mm-hmm. And he describes it as rain that comes down from the heaven.
Yeah.
And then as the rain hits the earth, it does what it needs to do.
Yeah.
It creates productivity on the earth.
Growth.
Growth. life. We get to drink water.
Healing, refreshes.
Yeah. And it actually is a way of keeping all life alive.
Yeah.
And so his words keep our lives alive.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we were talking a little bit earlier on in the conversation about negative energies that we bring from our past.
Mm-hmm.
So when we access this level of God's energy, it's not that God, that we have to try and work out how to get rid of the negative energy. Mm-hmm. It just is. As the rain comes down, as his word is spoken out of our lives, it just recreates.
Yeah, it buds. It brings forth.
It recreates. And so all of the negative stuff, we don't have to try and work that out of our lives.
Every time you try to do that,
yeah.
I'm not going to think that thought. Not going to think that
right.
thought. Not going to, no, I'm not going to be mad. Not going to be upset.
Yes. Yes.
Instead of just letting God's word be planted.
Exactly.
And let it bring forth.
A new harvest.
It almost like it, because if you look at, as it grows up, it's almost like there's no room for.
Yes.
There's no room for the negative growth.
Yes.
It's almost like the healthy growth of God's word all of a sudden consumes the negative in our heart.
Right.
You know, and consumes how we think. And all of a sudden it's like how you used to think, you don't think anymore.
Yes.
And
exactly.
And that's the word of God is so transformative.
Right. So, I over the years, I've had this visualization, Pastor Justin. Actually, the Lord gave me a dream. Which I sometimes refer back to, but I actually began to get this revelation and this visualization that as I speak the word of God out of my mouth, and it's based on the Bible, I literally see little packets of energy coming out of my mouth.
Energy packets.
Energy packets. That energy packets and that energy that is God's word. It's life. It's light, and it's sent out of my mouth, and it goes into my future.
Mm-hmm.
Even if that future is a minute from now, even if it's a year from now, maybe it's 10 years from now, I see these mm-hmm. energy packets, and they land, and wherever they land, they begin to create.
Mm-hmm.
And so as I walk into the future of that energy, I'm walking into the energy of God's word that has created my paths.
Mm-hmm.
It's created my future. It's created. So
yeah.
I'm not focused anymore on what I have to leave behind.
Yeah.
Because now the more I do that, I'm walking into the energy that God has sent that says will not come back to me mm-hmm. void. So it's not going to come back to me either.
Yeah.
Without substance.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking of a lot of times we used it for giving and those things, but understanding the sower sows the word.
Yes.
And thinking of the scripture, I guess it's in Isaiah, I'm not drawing a blank on the reference, but it says, cast your bread
right
upon the water.
Yes, yes.
And it will return to you after
many days.
And so with that, they were nomads. And what they would do is they would, what they didn't eat, they would throw into the water.
Right.
And as they would go downstream, by the time they would transition, when they went farther downstream, all of a sudden there was a harvest down there.
Exactly.
Because they cast their bread upon the water.
Yeah.
So in the future, they knew they were going in that direction. There was a harvest there already.
And you know, that's how some other prophets have been talking about how the reaper will overtake the harvester.
Yeah.
You know, the sower.
Yeah,
the
Amos,
reaper.
Yeah.
In Amos will overtake the sower. How's that possible? Well, when you get to the future, you're reaping a harvest that you've already sown. And so as you get there, you're already harvesting
mm-hmm.
stuff that you've put into the future from the past.
Right.
So the way it works is that it feels like I haven't sowed towards this, and I'm reaping, and I'm reaping, and I'm reaping. Well, because those energies have created. And as you transition from energy to energy to energy, it builds on itself.
Yeah. You even just had this thought. I remember having a conversation, personal conversation with the Lord concerning things that were happening in my life at a time. And I asked the Lord, I said, why did this happen? And why did this come about? And he goes, it's just harvest.
Right.
And now, then I look back and how I got to that place. It was like, it was harvest. And so the Lord said, he goes, do you want a different harvest?
Yeah.
Do you want a different harvest in your life?
Yes.
Because you're experiencing this because of the harvest of the way you've been thinking. And your thinking is a product of your words, and your thinking is that then turns into your actions, your behaviors, and then produces your destiny.
Right.
So it was like, do you want a different harvest? And so therefore, I was like, wait a minute. I made those decisions because of my thought life.
Right.
So I need to change this, so I change this.
Right.
So that's what it was. The Lord was just like, wasn't upset. It wasn't an upset voice. He was like, Justin, do you want a different harvest? He goes, then you need to change your thinking.
Amen. You know, the way that this whole scripture sort of underlines so many different things. If you're thinking God's ways rather than your ways, if you're thinking His higher thoughts, His higher ways, if you're putting the word out there, the word of God is changing us, so that when we get to what our words have created, as per Hebrews 11, God, the word says that the world was created by the words of God that He spoke.
Yeah.
So as we speak the words of God, our world is created. Now our thinking is in line with the harvest that's waiting for us.
Yeah.
Many times there's a harvest that people can't see because they haven't changed their mind.
Yeah.
They haven't had the word of God change the energy of their mind. Their energy is still fearful. Their energy is still lacking confidence. Their energy is still being protective and all of that. And so the two things work together.
Yeah.
You know, if you don't conform to the ways of this world, but you are transformed by the renewing of your mind, then you will know the will of God.
Yeah.
As you get there, you will know the will of God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think what hinders us a lot of times is the fact of the time, going back to the time.
Right.
Nothing's happening.
Yes.
Or this is just a waste of time. And not realizing, no, it's everything.
It's everything.
And it's like, oh, you know, that's why when I came to Texas, people asked, well, why can't you just go to Bible school here? Just go to church.
Right.
Why? It's like, you're going to waste all that time? No, it wasn't wasted time.
No.
No, it changed me.
Yes.
And we're running out of time, but I want to close with this in Matthew 13, and this is a chapter, and I'm just going to do the first part of it and let you say something about it. And it's something that I've gone to really for the last 5 years at the beginning of each year, and without taking too much time. In Matthew 13, verse 9, it says, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." And the disciples came and said to him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He answered and said to them, "Because it's been given to you, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven." So then it says, "But to them it has not been given, for whoever has." What is the has? The has is the ears to hear.
Correct.
And then it says, that person has ears to hear. It says, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. And that connects with those words that God speaks that bring forth and bud.
Right.
If I have ears to hear, He will give me more.
Right.
And I have abundance.
Exactly. And so just briefly to say a last comment about that, it goes to the fact that as I have a willingness to hear and a willingness to say, I want more, Lord.
I want more.
Yeah. Then that transforms you,
so
and
good.
The mystery of it begins to be revealed to you.
Yeah.
And as that mystery, I see it's working. Yes, the abundance is there.
Right.
I want more of it.
I want more.
Yeah, then it's not hidden from me anymore like it is to those who don't want to hear.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's been so good.
Thank you, Pastor John. Justin.
And thank you for joining me today. And I'm just so grateful for you.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you for joining us and connecting with this podcast today. And I want to close out in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for all those that connect with us each week with Winning Podcast. And I thank you that this word, Father, which is energy, has gone into them and is provoking and causing transformation in their lives. We speak forth abundance. We speak forth the word of God that will cause things to bring forth and bud in their lives. And we just thank you for your faithfulness over our lives. In Jesus' name,
In Jesus' name.
Amen. We love you. God bless. And go give him Jesus.
Go give him Jesus.